He's very optimistic that eventually the story that this video tells will maybe make it a little bit of difference in people's lives. So he's hoping. So anyway, anybody with any questions or comments, I'd be more than happy to entertain you. And I don't quite know what's going on with the food, but you feel free to go out, get food, come back, whatever you want to do. So somebody over there had a question?
How much of the fish that's caught in Scituate is actually sold in Scituate?
Very little. The problem is what's called a supply chain. Fish is perishable. You know, once it's caught, something has to be done with it really quickly, particularly in days like today when it's 90 degrees. But, you know, it still has a shelf life that's pretty short compared to other products. So the only place that we are able to process in Scituate right now is Mulaney's Fish Market on Allen Street. And the most we can do is a few hundred pounds a day. And Scituate landed last year of brownfish, the cod, haddock, flounder, pollock, that list of species, about 725,000 pounds. So we can't do 5% of what comes into Scituate. Plus the problem, of course, is the fluctuation in supply. All days aren't nice days. You know, we were lucky that maybe 200 days out of the 365 days in the year, the boats can actually go out because of weather. They're small boats, they're weather dependent. So if you set up a big fish factory, it's going to sit idle 50% of the time. There's a lot of technical problems that need to be resolved. We haven't gotten anywhere yet. We'd love to eventually be able to start freezing large amounts of fish. Frozen fish is not necessarily bad fish, as I think it mentioned in the video. It's what happens to the fish before it gets frozen that really determines its quality. If it's super fresh, super good fish when it's frozen, when it's thawed, it's still super good. So freezing is one of our alternatives. We haven't been able to do it yet because of the capital cost, but we're looking at that. But the answer, the short answer to your question is not enough fish gets processed locally. Sir?
How many fishing boats are family-owned are there out of Scituate Harbor?
Six.
Yes, sir. What's the most abundant species that are brought into Scituate? What makes up most of the catch?
Different species of flatfish, generically known as flounders, yellowtail flounder, winter flounder, sea dabs, and gray sole, I think by weight are the greatest. The most abundant fish used to be codfish, but codfish is still there in abundance, but it's terribly constrained by quota. In other words, right now the government sets the number of pounds that each permit holder, each boat can land, and that is the constraint. So once that quota is hit, they either have to lease more quota from somebody else or stop fishing. Those are the two choices you have. So more and more we've shifted away from codfish and towards these different flatfish species, which now makes up the predominant amount of catch.
How about dogfish or sand shark?
Dogfish is there. It's been a difficult product to market. It doesn't keep well. There's no processing in Scituate. The only processing that goes on now is in New Bedford. We have one truck that goes to New Bedford periodically with dogfish. It has to be landed and shipped every day because it's so subject to decomposition. It turns rancid really quickly. And it's very, very low priced. You know, the ex-vessel price of dogfish is probably, I don't know, 30 or 40 cents, I'm guessing, I'm not sure why. So you need a lot of dogfish. You know, it's 10% of maybe 15% in value of a pound of anything else. There's a few boats that do it that's so targeted. It's a short seasonal fishery, it doesn't go on year round. It's a migratory fish that's only here during the summer and fall months for the most part. Is an important part of the catch. It could be worth a lot more than it presently is. We are not doing what we should be doing with it, unfortunately. Yes, sir?
I used to see mako shark on menus, and I never have not seen them in many years. Is shark ever edible? Was mako shark edible still? Or?
Oh, it certainly is. You know, I honestly don't know the intricacies of the shark fishery. It's caught with a different gear type. The gear type that we're basically Scituate boats are using primarily are either bottom trawl or gill nets. So, you know, the larger sharks are pelagic in nature and they're usually caught with hooks. I know they're still caught by recreational fishermen. There is no commercial fishery for large sharks in Scituate anymore. And the catch is regulated by species. I'm not even sure what the status of mako sharks is, but a number of different species of sharks now are prohibited to be taken because they're considered to be overfished, or they're actually listed on the endangered or threatened species list of fish.
But they're edible.
Oh, absolutely. There's nothing that comes out of the ocean that's not edible. And some are difficult to market, some are difficult to process, some are difficult because of the regulatory system, but they're all edible.
Did I understand that you could buy fish in the supermarket
that has
antibiotics in it?
Yes, that's part of the problem. Part of the problem is, well you buy local fish, you know. But seriously, part of the story was the fish that they showed being aquacultured, these farms where people were feeding fish, there's antibiotics in the water so the fish don't get diseased and die off because they're so crowded together. You know, normally in nature, fish don't exist that close together. So part of the antibiotics is that. Part of the antibiotics is in the processing to keep the fish from spoiling, to preserve its shelf life. You know, I mentioned how difficult it is to process fish. It's very temperature sensitive, and it you know, breaks down over time much more quickly than other types of food. So antibiotics is introduced into the supply chain there as well. So the secret to antibiotic free fish is by local fish that was caught yesterday, prepared today, and dinner tonight. In the back?
I used to listen to Captain Lou on Sundays on WATDE. He talked a lot about fishery, you know, the whole NOAA thing and the regulations and catch shares. But he did mention that observers had to be on the fishing boats and they were paid by the fishermen. Is that still the case?
Not quite. They're on the boats, but right now they're being paid by the taxpayers. This was that Loper Bright case, the Chevron deference, just was decided by the Supreme Court a week before last. Maybe some of you have heard of that, but that was the issue. So what's happened in New England is that there's a 90% observer coverage. In other words, 9 out of 10 fishing trips have to have an observer present. That cost right now is being picked up by a subsidy that's introduced by, I don't even know where, the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission. I'm actually the guy that writes the checks to the observers. It's costing around between $800 and $1,000 a day for that observer. So there's no way that it's cost effective. But it's, let me just go off on a quick digression here if I can, because this is a real sore point with me. All those observers are doing is basically monitoring compliance. In other words, with everything that you say you did on your logbook, you actually did, we're watching you, so you can't get away with anything. You know, you fished in the right place, you fished for the right species, you didn't neglect to list anything. There's a huge story that this observer program Vitel, which is collecting what's called fishery-dependent data. At the very beginning of the video, they talked a little bit about, you saw the big research vessel, the Henry Bigelow going through the canal, the big white boxy-looking vessel. That is what counts the fish in the ocean off New England, that one boat. What we need to do is have more eyes on the water looking at how many fish there are, and then there might be eventually a better coordination between what the fishermen see and what the science says is actually out there. Part of our problem today is there is not. We have abundance of some things that the system says is scarce, and we have scarcity of some things that the system says are abundant, and they don't mesh well. So That observer program has some value, could have a lot more value, and could actually possibly pay for itself, probably not at $800 a day, but somebody collecting data, you know, where did you fish, what was your catch per unit effort, what was the species mix, things of that sort that could be used in stock assessments. So right now it's money down a rat hole as far as I'm concerned.
You said there were 6 boats in the fishing fleet. That doesn't include
lobsters? No, that's 6 boats that are permitted into the federally permitted multi-species or groundfish. That's the Clyde Haddock flounder fishery. There are 3 smaller boats that fish state waters only. That's up to 3 miles. They have a separate permit from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. They fish independently. They can't go into federal waters. And then there's about 25 lobster boats. There's also a couple of boats that fish for scallops, either in state or in federal waters, and a couple of boats that fish for sea clams in primarily state waters. So there's a diverse fleet here. The majority of the poundage is coming from the groundfish. The majority of the value is probably coming from the lobsters. There's probably, I'm just guessing here, 20 or 25 families still in town that make a portion or the majority of their livelihoods from the sea, from a variety of fisheries. You know, people move from fishery to fishery seasonally, and you know, it's still hanging on. It's not the what would you call it? The multi-generational fishery that it used to be. You know, the offspring of fishermen would become fishermen as well. It's changed a lot, and you know, it's basically it's hanging on right now by its fingernails. You know, there's a great opportunity here in terms of the numbers of fish in the ocean. The stumbling point right now is economics. You know, there is not enough money. The cost of procuring those fish is almost higher than the value of those fish. And a lot of those costs are imposed through inflation, through mandatory things like observers and reporting, and oh, there's a ton of different imposed costs.
With the lobster fleet, has their catch been limited by the regulatory?
Their system has been regulated. Their fishery.
Think about the right whale migration.
Yeah, so they're closed in the months of March, February, March, and April now. Every year, February through April, the lobster gear, anything with floats on it has to be removed from the ocean because of the right whale migration. And there's a couple of fishermen I know that are working on this ropeless gear where there's a acoustic release mechanism on the pots that pops the buoy to the surface when they're ready to retrieve it, but it's not ready for prime time yet. They're still working on it. Okay, there was a question up in back, and I'll get over to you. Yes?
Hi. Beside the farm-raised fish being fed an abundance of antibiotics, what are they feeding the farm-raised fish to eat?
Fish. Generally fish. Fish scraps.
Fish scraps?
Yeah. You know, fish meal, fish that's been dehydrated and minced, but usually that's what they're feeding them. So basically the waste product from processing the aquaculture fish goes back to feed more aquaculture fish. Oh, and the point is?
Yeah, so I had a question about the cost differential between selling in the wholesale market versus dock to table, selling into retail. What's the retail cost or retail revenue available to a fisherman if he or she's able to sell to retail versus
I actually tried it the last few years that I was fishing. It's costly. I mean, you can't be in two places at once. So the first problem is that you need another party involved in between, which they did show here, this dock-to-dish program. It's very small, and of course, you saw that they didn't buy all the fish. You know, that all that fish has to go, so what doesn't go to dock-to-dish eventually has to go to the normal wholesale market. Another obstacle is that you can't process on the boat. There's a couple of different fisheries that can sell direct. One is the scallop fishery, another is the lobster fishery. And people have taken advantage of those opportunities and done quite well at it. Right now, there's, I think, two fishermen in Scituate that are selling scallops direct marketing. They're on Facebook. So they're there. The groundfish fishery that I was involved in and still am with the different projects that we've been doing is very, very difficult. There's a reporting requirement. You have to sell to a licensed dealer. You can't just become Joe the fishmonger. You know, you have to have a facility that's refrigerated, that's USDA approved for sanitation. There's just a lot to it. It's beyond the capabilities of an individual running a one or two person boat to do in addition. What we hope to do, this local catch 143's hope is to be able to grow the local market to the point where it begins to provide a little bit of a positive cash flow for the wholesale market, which, as you correctly point out, right now is depressed and not providing enough revenue. So you know, if we can get 10%, 15%, 20% of the fish diverted into a semi-direct, a more direct supply chain, not necessarily just selling the individual fish to another individual, but selling through a truncated supply chain instead of fish going to a truck, going to here, going to there, the fish goes to the Malayan process and goes to the consumer. You know, two steps instead of four or five steps is our approach to it right now. In the back is?
There was a wonderful documentary and a lot of credits and a lot of places that they had to go. Where did the funding come from?
Darby is not making any money in this. We actually paid him for this. He's not very happy about what happened because basically the film is not marketing well. You know, he went to a different, what do they call them? Festivals, film festivals, and it didn't make enough money to recover his cost. So we're basically paying for these screenings, we may be doing one or two more, and he gets a piece of it, but it's not a profitable business, it's kind of like fishing.